Hey everyone, thank you for joining us. What a reminder today that God's goodness is running after us. From the moment that we wake up until we lay our head, we'll be singing the goodness of God. Thank you, worship team, for leading us into a time of worship. Let's get right into the message. I have titled this talk, Far From God and Too Close to the World. Far from God and too close to the world. I want to zero in on Matthew 17, verse 14 through 18. And when they came to the crowd, a man came to him and kneeling before him and said, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he has seizures and he suffers terribly. For often he falls into the fire and often into the water. And I brought him to your disciples. They could not heal him. And Jesus answered, O faithless and twisted generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him, and the boy was healed instantly. Here is two powerful words that Jesus used in this text. O faithless and twisted generation. Some translation says, O faithless and corrupt generation. How long shall I put up with you? Faithless means disconnected from God. Twisted generation means too connected to the world. Here are the people in the story, red-faced disciples, devastated father, epileptic son, and Jesus. Here is the location. Jesus and the three disciples came down to the mountain of transfiguration to rejoin the remaining disciples. The next scene tells us that the teachers of the law were arguing with the disciples, indicates that the teachers of the law had been tailing Jesus and his disciples wherever they go, looking for more evidence against them of violating the law. And now as Jesus, Peter, James, and John came down from the mountain and returned to the other nine disciples, a crowd had gathered because of an argument about an attempted healing of an epileptic boy. His father approached Jesus with great reverence and says, Lord, have mercy on my son. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire and into the water. This man is like many today, disappointed and devastated. The disciples are like many Christians today, powerless. Listen, the placing of the story after the transfiguration shows that the Son of God can do anything if only people, Jews and Gentiles alike, can trust in him. So often when knowledge about God grows, actual dependence on God diminishes. Matthew goes out of his way to let us know the danger of the lack of faith. He has a lot to say about the failure of the disciples. This is an important lesson we must take note, that the more settled and established a church body becomes, the more it needs to learn we cannot achieve nothing without sincere dependence on the Lord. Amen to that. In this story, the location of this event is Caesarea Philippi. Jesus encounters this boy and demonstrates his power over evil. His disciples try to cast out the demon, but they failed due to their weak faith. The glory of the king is seen in healing the epileptic boy. This is where the real battle is fought, not on a mountaintop of blessing, but the valley of sickness. Hallelujah. What we see in this story is a question and an answer. The disciples had been given the authority to do the healing, but they had not yet learned how to appropriate God's power. Jesus' frustration was with the unbelieving and the unresponsive generation, including the crowd, the teachers of the law, the man, and the nine disciples. We can reflect today and say the attitude of the unbelief is so prevalent in our society today. What we see in Matthew 17, we can sense Jesus' frustration. He dropped a bombshell. Tell us how you really feel, Jesus. He says, O faithless and perverse generation. Right about now, this is how Jesus feels. Faithless and corrupt generation. Men and women in our society, nation disconnected from God. And many of us are realizing that right now with the coronavirus crisis and racial injustice, especially in the recent passing of George Floyd, tension has been building for centuries. We've seen the death of Trayvon Martin, Michael Brown, Sandra Bland, and many others have led to the huge protest and spawned the Black Lives Matter movement. Surely God has given us the power that whatsoever we bind on earth is bound in heaven, and whatsoever we loose on earth is loosed in heaven, and we bind the spirit of racism, and we need to exercise this authority. We bind the spirit of racism. We bind the spirit of murder. There is no place in our kingdom for racism. There is no place for a murdering spirit. Jesus says, "O faithless, O unbelieving and corrupt generation, how long shall I put up with you?" We need to pray for people's heart to be transformed. This is a heart matter, heart issue, a spiritual matter. Lord, bind and remove misunderstanding that have caused people to look at each other with suspicious and judgmental eye. We bind the strongholds. We cast them down. We cast it out. We speak peace. May this be the beginning of justice coming from the inside. Many are moving more towards ungodliness than faith. Why? Because before this whole thing has happened, people are distracted, far from God, and too close to the world. This is the problem. Many are distracted from God. I want to give you 3 points that you should know. Number one, distraction causes you to lose focus and purpose. Number two, abandoned dreams lead you to defeat and despair. Number three, unbelief turns your faith from seeing what's possible. Point number one, distraction causes you to lose focus and purpose. Listen, Jesus dealt with this in Matthew 17. He had incredible disciples, loved the disciples, but they were distracted. They were distracted from their purpose. This is why we have to get focused on what God has called us to do. If Satan cannot destroy you, he will distract you. If he can't take you down, he will weigh you down. This is what the disciples did. They came to him in private. Verse 19 says, "Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, 'Why couldn't we drive it out?' He replied, 'Because you have so little faith. Truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move right away. Nothing will be impossible for you.'" Imagine how small their faith has been. He is saying, all you need is a tiny faith, and you didn't have enough of that. Let me tell you again, if Satan cannot destroy you, he will try to distract you. When I saw the news of George Floyd passing on Monday, May 25th, it revealed the evil of racism that exists in the human heart and the darkness that exists in the world. On Monday, May 25th, amplified the brokenness of the world we live in, poisoned every aspect of our humanity and society. On Monday, May 25th, we began by remembering the death of over 1 million men and women who died securing and defending our freedom. On Monday, May 25th, we mourn the death of 100,000 men, women, and children who died over the past few weeks as a result of COVID-19. Yet it was the death of one man in Minneapolis, a man by the name of George Floyd, that stood out among them all, revealing the evil of racism that exists in the human heart and the darkness that exists in the world. On Monday, May 25th, I saw the video of George Floyd being pulled from his minivan in a suspicion of a forgery of a $20 bill. After getting a complaint from the Minneapolis grocery store, he was handcuffed. He was pinned to the ground by three men, one of whom proceeded to press his knee to his neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, taunting him, all while George lied there gasping for air, pleading with the men who had arrested him, "Please, I can't breathe," and then lying unconscious for nearly the last 2 minutes. Hopefully that video was enough. Listening and watching the evil that we call racism play out before your own eyes. As your pastor, I pray that you would not allow yourself to become unimpacted by racism. As your pastor, I pray that you see that even though the Civil War has been won, even though the 13th Amendment had been passed that abolished slavery, even though the Civil Rights Act had been passed, racism has not been eradicated from our world and our hearts. Racism continues to poison every aspect of our humanity and society, but continues to infect our hearts to this very day, impacting both individually and collectively. There was a fourth man in the video in uniform in the scene. A man simply stood there, silent, watching, saying nothing and doing nothing. My fear is that many of us are guilty of passive racism, simply unaware of how our racist thoughts and actions and words that impact others. As a South Indian Malayali, I too denounce racism and declare Black Lives Matter. Let me tell you, passive racism only focuses on the fire that is raging, not on the spark that lit the fire. We should mourn the death of one fellow human being created in the image of God. We should lament the unjust suffering of so many for so long. We should denounce racism and white supremacy for what it is, evil. Here's the fact that many have said, when justice is coming from the inside, you will not see protest happening on the outside. Like so many have said, we need to do more than just an Instagram post. This is the issue of the heart. Not just that, we should repent of any racism, of any racial discrimination, of any prejudice that exists in our hearts. And we should hope, and we should hope because the good news of the gospel transforms life. We should hope because the day is coming, Christ shall return, and when He does, all of this ends and it will be restored and the things like racism won't exist anymore. We cannot remain silent and stand there and do nothing like the fourth man in the video. As we continue looking at the text we read today, Jesus confronts the inconsistency in disciples' lives. Their ways, their behavior did not align with the beliefs. It convicts us to actively live out our faith. Point number two, abandoned dreams lead you to defeat and despair. Don't let your dreams die. Here's my question. Who's driving your dreams? Right now in this season, who's driving your dreams? Some of us have been hurt, maybe anger, and we have picked up things in our life that never supposed to drive us. It's piloting our lives to pain. And pain is a bad pilot. Pain is a bad driver. Maybe it's a hurtful past and you allowed hurt to get into the driver's seat and drive you around destinations that will ultimately fail you. And if you find yourself, I don't feel like I have a purpose anymore. I'm just not content. I'm just not fulfilled. Somewhere along the line, you discard the dreams that God has placed in your heart and now we're stumbling through life on an autopilot. At some point, you have to realize, I gotta look beyond what I do with my life right now. I gotta place my dreams and my hopes in the hands of my holy God. Let's put our dreams and our hopes into the hands of the holy God. When God gives you a dream, it's always going to be attached to a dilemma. Let me tell you, God's problem solvers are people. God's problem solutions are people. And God is looking at you. What will you do? You want to find your purpose? Discover the problem God has destined you to solve. God destined me to solve the problem of discouraged hearts in people and in our society. Look at the life of Joseph. His life was favored by God and filled with problems. Your dreams will always be tested. If you're under pressure right now, understand that pressure has a purpose and it's not crushing you, it's pushing what's inside of you out. It's important for us to get this. Dreams will be tested by Satan and by God. If you read Psalms 105 verse 19, it says, until the time came to fulfill his dreams, the Lord tested Joseph's character. God can take you to the top, but your character will decide if you stay there or not. Let me tell you that. God can take you to the top, but your character will decide if you stay there or not. Joseph discovered this and he learned this in his life. When you have favor, you will have frenemies. People who look like friends, but they're actually enemies. The problem with most of us, when somebody challenges us too much, you get mad and you think they're criticizing you. That's why you need to be in a group that challenge you to step up, to be greater than what you are, to pray more, to fast more, to listen more, to understand more. Listen, opposition always signals transition. If you want to go somewhere in God and you ask God for a future, there will be challenges. It's literally like Super Mario Brothers. You gotta beat the little dragon at the end of the level one to get to the level two. The problem with some of us, we just wanna bounce and get mushrooms and coins and stay where we are. And you will say, can I get a jailbreak to get to level three? Nope, it doesn't exist in the kingdom. You gotta pass level one to get to level two. You gotta pass level two to get to level three. There's no shortcuts. Don't let your dream die. You discard the dreams that God has placed in your heart, and now you're stumbling through life on autopilot. Wake up, dream again. Let me remind you, abandoned dreams lead you to defeat and despair. This is the hope that we have in Christ, that the plans that God has for us is to prosper us, not to harm us, but to give us a hope and a future. Don't poison your future by what you do today. Live right. Dream again. Point number three, unbelief turns your faith from seeing what's possible. Unbelief turns your faith from seeing what's possible. Unbelief is a big problem right now. The disciples are like many Christians today, powerless. Were they powerless? Yes, it was caused by the lack of faith. So often when knowledge about God grows, actual dependence on God diminishes. Matthew goes out of his way to stress the danger of lack of faith. I don't understand why this is happening to me. When confronted with a case that calls for deliverance, I know how impossible it can feel that one can accomplish anything. But afterwards, one looks back on the mountain mood with joy and gratitude. Now here's what verse 19 says. Then came the disciples to Jesus in private and said, "Why could we not cast out?" "Because of your little faith," Jesus told them. "For if you had faith even as small as a tiny mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move, and it will go far away. Nothing would be impossible. Bring him here to me." Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy. As always, when Jesus healed, the cure was complete. When Jesus healed, the cure was complete. Jesus wasn't condemning the disciples for substandard faith. He was trying to show how important faith would be in their future ministry. It is the power of God, not our faith, that moves mountain, but faith must be present to do so. The mustard seed was the smallest seed known, but the mustard seed grew into a large garden plant. Even a small seed of faith is sufficient. Hallelujah. There is great power, even with a little faith, when God is with us. If we're facing problems that seem big and immovable as mountain, we must turn our eyes from the mountain and look to Christ for more faith. Then, as Jesus promised, nothing will be impossible. It is not the amount of faith that matters. Rather, it is the power of God available to anyone with even the smallest faith. Remember this, we cannot fail when we have faith. We cannot fail when we have faith. I pray that you would operate in faith. And what does faith do? It connects me to God. What else faith do? Disconnects me from the world. In a season right now, many are in a hard place, not working right now. Maybe you've been fired, or maybe you're fighting the virus, or maybe unrest, racial injustice. This is a heart issue, the spiritual issue that we must take responsibility. Where faith is alive and growing, God is present and active. Every day, pray for faith to grow. Every day, thank God for the connection that assures us that we're not alone, that there's no problem that you're facing today. God doesn't have a solution or an answer. We can find resolution, peace, and direction in His presence. Let me conclude. If you know you need to make Jesus the center of your life, this is your opportunity to get back with Him. The Bible says when you acknowledge Him, He will acknowledge you. God, I just need a lifeline. Your lifeline begins when you lift up your hand. Lord, I need it. I need you. It begins with yielding your life to Him. God, I trust you. I can't do this alone. I repent of my past. I come to you. Teach me to walk in your ways. Lord, I want to know you. I want to find freedom in you and discover my purpose and make a difference. I'm ready to say yes, yes to whatever it is that you want me to say yes to. Thank you, Lord, that I'm leaving here better, challenged, encouraged, and inspired. Thank you, Lord, I feel better, changed, transformed in Jesus' name. And everybody shouted, Amen, amen, hallelujah. It was great coming to you. Let's close our eyes for a benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen, amen.
Hey guys, thank you guys so much for watching tonight's episode of the Tonight Service with Sharon Fellowship Church. We hope you guys enjoyed it, and make sure you like, share, subscribe, and follow all our social media platforms for the latest updates and new content. As always, know that we're praying for you, and we love you, and we can't wait to see you all next time. Thank you, and God bless.